episode 29 of The Drop in the House, coming in hot MK on Friday, April 30th, the last day of April. And you know what that means, my friend.
Oh, it's gonna be May.
I knew you were waiting for that. I wanted to give you that tip off and let you get that out of your system.
I love it.
There you go.
It's gonna be May.
It's a perfect layup. Yes, tomorrow.
Although
is
I wish it was gonna be June.
Yes, I will. I'll take July at this point, to be honest with you. But we are almost there, my friend. We are almost there.
Oh my goodness.
We have been remiss, by the way, in not talking about this year's.
Yeah, I know. Look at us. We're magic.
The 2021 iteration of the finest, finest hoodie. We've had them for months.
Yeah.
And we have not discussed it.
No, we haven't. No.
And I feel a little remiss about that. Because, you know, you are the man behind the whole finest, finest movement.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
And the design element this year, I think, is fantastic.
Thank you. Yeah, I was just trying to go with that. You know, obviously, I'm ripping off of Champion, but
that's okay.
I felt like it was very current. I was trying to think of something that the students would wear, and it got a good reaction when we made these ones. So.
It did. I love it.
Think about the next one.
I know you are.
Now that the weather's getting warm, it's always on my mind. We got to get a T-shirt out. Hopefully, before the end of the year, would be nice.
Yes.
So that way, when we have our finest, finest Fridays, we don't have to be sweating in June.
That's true. Yes, and we want it to be the most up.
Within the next
we want it to be the most up to date.
Yes.
I don't want to keep wearing like my 5-year old finest, finest.
No, T-shirt. I gotta keep it fresh.
Yes. Yes. So we are continuing with my foray into gardening. I did get the fish diarrhea. Came in. I have to tell you, I almost got sick. Like that's man, that you did not.
I told
tell
you
me else, you did not prepare me for the pungency of that.
I describe it. It's like if you've ever like gone fishing or crabbing for the day, and you're working with live bait, and you're constantly putting bait on your hook. It's like what it smells like is your hand at the end of the day,
bro. What it smelled like to me was a restroom at a Tijuana truck stop. It was horrendous. I literally was gagging, and then I had to wipe the bottle. I had to throw all the rags that I used to wipe it down. I threw them right in the trash. I was like, I can't.
It lingers, so you don't want to get it on your clothes. And you gotta definitely watch when you're filling up like the watering can for splashback, because even diluted fish diarrhea for your garden, it's not smelling good. So
no, it is not.
Listen, it's going to pay off with the garden. I'm telling you, it always works. It's super.
Listen, my friend from your mouth to God's ears.
They used to make the pellets years ago, and now they don't make the pellets. It's only the liquid form. So I don't know. The pellets weren't bad because you didn't have to worry about it getting on your clothes.
No, but it's okay. Listen, like I said, if it gets me the same type of tomato plants that I have been admiring in your yard, then it's well worth it.
Yeah, it's worth it. Yeah,
it will work for me. Last thing I want to touch base on is these continuous NFTs are blowing up, man. I don't know how I feel about NFTs.
I think it's gonna come tumbling down.
Yeah.
Tumbling down. I feel like I'm seeing like more artists like NFT, 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 but then I'm like seeing like random like social media accounts, like just going through like old posts or old videos and then like just putting them up as NFTs. It's like, I don't know. I think it's a really risky investment, you know?
Yes, I agree.
I feel like it's like too many people in it right now. And it's like,
it's being saturated. It's already getting saturated.
It's saturated. Yeah. It's like, you know, supply and demand. There's too much supply right now, and I think that these prices on these things are going to go down, or I think it's going to be a fad. I really do.
Yeah,
I hope so too.
I do too. I think that it's ruining the studio experience for a lot of artists.
Yeah,
and I think that, you know, the guest that we have on today, I think, is a prime example of why studio practices are still so necessary.
Yeah,
like Tara Lewis. We have Tara Lewis on today. And great. Just a phenomenal painter.
Great,
like, yeah, very personal, great, great personality, great energy. Just, you know, came with the energy right out of the bat. Was fantastic. But like I said, like she's a painter's painter. Like I don't see her subject matter being suitable for an NFT. Like she's a painter. She needs to be in the studio. You need to see that work in person, which we've been lucky enough to have seen in person. And that's, I don't want to lose that. And you know me, I'm the guy that's smelling it and licking it in the gallery. Like, I don't want to be resorted to a screen. I've had enough screen experience to last me a lifetime.
Yeah. I think it's just too, it's not like for like the artist, like the NFT is not the, it's not, I feel like it's not like what they're not trying to create pieces for NFTs. They're not trying to, you know, it's the work is not made for NFTs. To me, it's almost like they're taking like the garbage of their work, like the remnants of it, the byproducts of it, and then, and then selling it. Cause I'm seeing like a lot of people posting like, selling NFTs of reference photos that they did, or like little animations that they make from one of their painting and selling that as a video NFT. But like, I don't feel it. I so far, I don't feel like people are making work for NFTs yet, which I'm happy about. It's more like, oh, I got this and I'll throw this up there and see how it does. But
right, and see if I can make some extra money on the side, like a side hustle. It's like an artist side hustle right now.
Yeah. But I don't know.
That's just.
I don't think it's risky for the artist. Obviously, I don't think it's. I think all the risk is in the investors that go for it. But if the artist can make money on it, I guess we got to be all for it. But
I just hope it's not the wave of the future.
I don't think it could last. I don't know. But I could be. I'm probably totally wrong.
I hope not. Before we get to the episode, I want to shout out also to all of our seniors on commitment day today.
Yeah, I didn't even know it was commitment day. Usually they're like,
commitment day is usually traditionally May 1st, but since May 1st falls on the Saturday, they were doing it April 30th.
The email telling us to wear our college sweatshirts.
Yeah, well, and listen, finest Friday trumps everything anyway, so it doesn't matter. I would have been wearing this no matter what, but I do also want to give a personal shout out to my senior Skylar for committing. She's going to Stony Brook University for creative writing. We are very proud of you, and we look forward to some great, great things in your future. Way to go, kiddo.
Absolutely.
So we are on to episode 29, my friend.
29.
Strap in. Enjoy the ride, because here comes Miss Tara Lewis on the drop. We have a phenomenal guest with us this week. We have Miss Tara Lewis from New York City is with us. We have been trying to get Tara on for a while. Tara, welcome to the drop.
Thank you. I'm very honored. I hope a lot of like high school kids watch this too.
Oh, yes.
Sure they will.
That's the best audience. No offense to everybody else, but Tom, I'm glad you're here too. Tom Senior, right? But
yes, Tom Senior is in the house too. Yes, as always. He's our biggest fan.
I wish I had this kind of thing when I was, high school kids age. I wish I could watch things like this. So
yeah, it's been a blessing for us. This is one of the silver linings of this pandemic for MKI. Okay. Is the ability to do this. And it's actually, we'll give you a little backstory on how we discovered Tara. Speaking of teenagers, my oldest daughter, Skylar, who just turned 18, is a big fan of Tara's work, so much so that she was inspired in some of her advanced placement. Her body of work was very, very influenced by, she just loves Tara's style and her subject matter and her pop culture. And she said, "Dad, do you know Tara Lewis?" I said, "Yeah, I follow Tara Lewis." And she's like, "You got to see her stuff is great." And I said to her, I said, "Well, why don't you DM her?" That's the beauty to me of social media, is the fact that you can, like I told MK, we talk about this all the time. If we had the ability in high school to reach out to, like, let's say a Chuck Close.
No kidding. Or,
like somebody that we really looked up to, that we studied in high school, and they answered us back in real time. Holy mackerel.
Would have fainted on the ground. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's unbelievable. Exactly. So she did. She reached out to Tara, and she was so excited when you answered her back. Almost like within a couple of hours, she was like, she texted me at work. She's like, "Dad, Tara Lewis messaged me."
Oh my God, that's so cute. Okay, well, same though. It made my day, because that's like the biggest compliment to have somebody her age reach out. That's like, that's authentic. That's the real thing.
Yeah. So we reached out to Tara and she was very excited to be a part of this, and we're very excited to have her on. So we had a great pre-check with Tara. We actually rescheduled. Tara had a little bit of a scheduling problem last week, and we were like, that's fine, not a problem. So we actually had a great pre-check with her 2 weeks ago, and you know, we just were discussing all kinds of great stuff, which we're going to get to today. She's in her studio in New York. So it's great that we get to see you in your environment. Maybe you can give us a quick peek around at some point, and we'll see what you're working on. So what we love to do, Tara, is we always like to start off our episode with what we affectionately call our artist origin story.
Okay.
Talk a little bit about where you grew up, your background, your aha moment where as a kid you decided this is what I want to do for the rest of my life, and how that gravitated towards the path that you're on now. So why don't you tell us a little bit about where you grew up and your experiences, particularly for our students. They love the, what were you like in high school? Was art a big part of your life in high school? How did you decide that art was the path you wanted?
Yeah, no, that's great. Okay, so I grew up in a super small town in New Hampshire, which was probably like kind of near Exeter. It's near the coast, like 10 minutes from the beach, and then maybe 45 minutes north of Boston. So not the woods, not the mountains. I feel very comfortable. The woods and the mountains scare me. We used to go to the Cape on trips. We never went to, you know, the woods. That's a whole other thing. I'm scared of bugs and stuff. But so I grew up and it was basically a farm with no animals, like lots of gardens and fields. And I grew up, actually the road I grew up on was a dirt road when I was a kid. So we had like one neighbor. I was born in 1970. So there's a store, like a little country store you could ride your bike to. And I had a basket on my bike with a little bell and the flag, you know, banana bikes. And I had like a flag.
Yeah.
You know, and it was pretty remote, and it was just an old, you know, colonial house. So we didn't have tons of money or anything. But so when things like like People magazine would come in the mail, or like pop culture, if I get any like grasp of, I was so excited. I was thirsty for culture. It was just really kind of like I didn't have any friends on my street. I had a sister who was 5 years older, so I was an annoyance. You know, I was like, you're the babysitter built in. And my parents are super creative, really, really creative, artistic parents. So they're antique dealers, but they were finished things. They're refurbished things. My mom's done like middle school theater directing. My dad was a graphic designer, and there's really just hands-on creative. So I used to like kind of entertain myself a lot of the time. So I would make up little games to do outside. And so that was always in me to like find your own fun, right?
Right.
But I could always draw. So I could draw as a little kid. And my parents, like, I think a lot of parents you've heard this whole, you know, common story of like, don't go into art, you won't make any money, and da 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 da. And my parents were very supportive. You know, I got really good grades in school. I was kind of like an honor roll dork. Like I got really straight A's, won spelling bees, stuff like that. Which I think was attributed to being visual, because I memorized what they look like, the words. That's all about visual. But being at a little age or small age, I could draw really well. And that was something that I had terrible art teachers in school. I really did. Like they were not terrible, but I didn't really learn as much as I could have. And I wouldn't blame it on the person, but maybe the school and the way the structure was set up back then. And it wasn't an affluent community. So I tried, you know, to learn what I could, but I would always draw on my own. And my mom would try to find local little things to do. So my first exhibit, I want to say it was first or second grade, the town library had an art show and I drew the Mona Lisa. I was so excited and they put it on an easel and I thought I was at the Met. Like I thought, I've made it now. Like I have an exhibit up, and honestly, like, I don't know where that is, that Mona Lisa. I would kill for it. That's one piece of advice for anybody, is keep things that you make, like make sure you keep.
You always say that.
Yeah. I don't have anything, right? I have one drawing that I think I sent to you. Like it's a drawing of Jim Morrison I did in high school. I thought, oh wow, I can draw people. Like I like the pop culture thing. Anyway, that later. I tried, you know, I did really well. I really was into academics and I tried really well in school, but I always had that skill and I tried to hone it. So if I got a summer job, it would be art related, right? Or when I was applying to college, I made sure I had a portfolio built. I think I took some courses at a local college to fill in, continuing ed to fill in the blanks I couldn't get in high school. And what do you do when you are at home in this like really rural place. And I would draw from magazines, right? People magazine, or the town library had 17. That was cool. You know, and Vogue magazine was like, whoa. And I was young. I was like 10 or 11. And I went to the town library, and the librarians were scary back then, like super scary. And I looked at 17 magazine there because we didn't subscribe to it. And I thought, ooh, I want to look at the ads, the hair, the faces, because everything's well lit, right? Like right. I could see people and shadows, and I wanted to sketch from things that were really clear. And I liked drawing people. And I also liked pop culture and stuff like that. So one day in the library, I've told the story before, the librarian told me I couldn't read it because I wasn't 17, and like told my mom, small town, like Tara was reading like risque stuff. And like, oh my God, like what is happening? So, you know, and then of course MTV evolves, right? And then we got a TV and we got Atari. And I was like, whoa, like my life, things are getting really exciting now. I tried to soak whatever I could up, you know, from my environment. Yeah, so that was kind of how I started. And then, I learned technical skills in college.
I know that you, according to your bio, you went to University of New Hampshire. Yep. You did your undergrad there. And then you did your graduate degree at Tufts.
Yes.
Through the museum, Boston Museum of Fine Arts.
Yes.
So how did you find, without that high school guidance, how did you decide that going to college for art was what you wanted to do?
That's interesting. Yeah, it's funny because the high school what didn't give me the guidance. My parents, particularly my mom, was like, if you want to make money, be a commercial, back then it was called commercial art, you know? Mm-hmm. So pursue commercial art, be an illustrator, that will get you jobs to like, because the computers didn't exist, right? So yeah, people, not, I mean, you still need people to draw, right? But I thought, well, that could be, so graphic design was something I thought, well, I can kind of do a job in that realm after college. And it's funny because, yeah, I kind of entered into an art major thinking, okay, so I'm going to have like a very small, I have some Pell Grants and things like that. So I went to UNH and I'm just going to be straight shooter. I majored in my sorority. I loved it. I was really social because I hadn't, it was like a Chi Omega all the way, but I actually, but doing art, like I was serious about my art too. So I did, painting, drawing, printmaking, photography. But it was a program that didn't give me the commercial, the contemporary art infusion I needed and wanted and didn't even know I wanted. Right. So I love what you're doing right now. So I learned technical skills that were amazing, right? But I didn't get that kinetic, you know, there was no real bridge to the art world being shown to me. Like there was no path. It was like, okay, hone this skill and then find a job. And that was like it. And there was no like, you know, where do you go? So I was super social. That was good. And people skills come in handy in the art world. They really do.
Yes.
So it's weird how you can find the value or silver lining in anything that you do. Right. So yeah. So then, yeah, I left and did the museum school. Between those two, I did find a job in graphic design right away, which kind of is shocking. The Museum of Fine Arts had a design department in Boston, and they hired a design assistant, which was me, to design the banners that went on the museum on the front.
Oh, okay.
Wow, like that's so cool. But you're in like the basement of the building, you never see artwork, and you're just doing like, you're copying what the publications department's telling you the font is. So in terms of, I thought, wait a minute, I'm creative, I can draw. This is not, I don't want to.
It wasn't creative enough for you.
Yeah. What's the end game? I'm at a desk over there with the better desk and I'm like, no. So I volunteered on the weekends to be an art teacher in the attic of the museum had a great space where you could take little school groups. I know this is common now, but back then it was like kind of a new thing. And you could take kids to the little, like the kimonos gallery, and then they could like make a little folded paper kimono and draw on that. And so I thought, oh, this is fun, like people, like interacting with people and the art. And what is the art about? And how does the viewer respond to it if they're 5 years old or if they're 15 years old? Like that to me was like, wow, I wish I could have had that experience, you know? So kind of opened my eyes. I think if you want to be an artist and sell paintings and whatever you do, it's good to have jobs in the arts in different places because you learn behind the scenes, you meet different people. So it's a good thing to get your finger in all this, kind of figure out what you want to do. And the practical thing is, you know, get a paycheck, get benefits, maybe you sell painting someday, but you can find your way. So I did that and then went back to school to do like painting and things like that. And I taught for a while too and made the leap to kind of just making a lot of paintings and making that a business model.
I didn't mean to cut you off, but this is the whole point, and we reiterate this on every episode, is really the point of what MK and I are doing with this program, not just exposing our kids to this contemporary scene, but also to give them a working knowledge of the business aspect of being an artist. So how did you, like you just, it made me think of this question because you just said about having a business model. How did you start to develop because it sounds to me like you weren't getting that at the collegiate level either.
No.
So how do you discover this business model? Yeah, what did you do?
So I was teaching a portrait class to advanced students, and I thought I had a prep school, and I thought, you know, like I should make a demo portrait. And I thought, when you teach, you forget to make your own work. That can happen. But yeah. Me, it's like hand in hand, right? So I thought, I'm going to do a demo painting portrait. I found a subject, and it was like these two, like the heart glasses. And it was, I just used Payne's gray and made it monochromatic and stretched the canvas. And I taught stretching canvases too. And I thought, I'm going to have this in the classroom. Honestly, I thought, okay, now I want to just, this particular experience with this model that could really propel, it was just a good like springboard. And then I got addicted to it. So I found a formula for what I wanted to do in terms of to be practical in terms of materials, in terms of scale, in terms of like studio practice, the process, how do I do it? Where does the idea come from? Like Fast Times at Ridgemont High, I love movies, right? Like anything like that. I got the book and read it. That's really interesting because Cameron Crowe went into high school undercover and nobody knew he was undercover for a magazine.
Right. Yes.
And then he became friends with everybody. And then Sean Penn lived in his apartment building in LA. And he was like, can you want to be in the movie? You're my friend. So the way he did that was very, very cool. And I thought, okay, I like the research behind this, the painting, and the painting's telling a story. So in the minute art starts to tell a story or express something, and it's coming from your life experience. Life experience is the best informer of work, right? So I love like fashion. I like graphic design. I like fonts. I like pop culture. I like people. And I like portraits. So I thought, you know, I grew up like sketching Brooke Shields' face as a kid or like any celebrity I could find. So then to find a real subject and kind of, you know, I don't know how to put it, maybe just adorn them with props or work collaboratively with a model. I thought this has potential and it's what I want to do. It's how I want to spend my time. So you should want to spend your time doing it. If you're making paintings and it's not fun and pleasurable, you got to like figure out something else to do with your paint, with your art, right? Maybe you have to try some printmaking. Maybe you have to draw some more or collect a bunch of photographs. Or maybe you go to some flea market and find something wacky and fun. Or maybe so it's usually your life experience and what's around you tells the best story, like a writer, like a musician, right?
That's what connects with the people the most too, because it's authentic.
A lot of like things in my life were sort of coming together and I thought, wow, I want to do a bunch of portraits that tell these stories and work with models and see where that goes and not have big expectations, but kind of see where the next portrait goes. And from there, like the demo I made ended up selling to some random person. Some people wanted to buy it. And I thought, okay, wow. So that's gone. And I thought, okay, that's sold. And then I started just really not using all of my time to do that. And it evolved into selling paintings, using the right materials, you know, making sure you take care of your work, making sure if a gallery wants to see it, you know, it's nice and it's something you're selling. There's all that. Because really galleries are stores. I mean, they're like clothing stores. Yeah. I say it that way.
Right.
So, and they're good people and they're not good people. You have to make sure they pay you, right? So you want to be careful who you deal with. But so I ended up just starting to do these portraits, and then, you know, then a website evolves, right? And this is like way before Instagram. This is a while ago. So I ended up, you know, building up the website and then also thinking like, how do I describe my studio practice or each painting with like two or three sentences? Don't ask, if I do it right now, it'll flop, by the way. But like, I usually, I usually, when I do a painting, I try to summarize it in a few sentences. That way, if there's a grant you apply to, you have that to plug in. But also, you stop and think, what am I doing, right? And why am I doing it? What's the title of the painting? Because really, it's like you're a writer. It's not that different from like telling a story and like, you know, and you don't have to know, you know, what it looks like in the end. Oh, you know, different artists work different ways, right? So I do photo shoots. And I don't have a model sit there. And I take a lot of pictures and I look through all of them. Sometimes I'll paint a different hand, you know, and a different like expression and change.
You know, it's interesting that you say that, Tara, because I've talked to other artists. And one that comes to mind immediately is James Ballou, who is a mural painter and a fine artist in Berlin, Germany, who I interviewed about 5 years ago. And he does the same thing where he takes multiple photographs and then he makes composites. Is that part of your practice? Like, is that something you set out to do right from the start, or did that evolve for you?
No, I was super obedient to photographs, and my husband is a genius. And he's like, you know, you gotta like think about what you want to do, set what you want to say. What do you want it to do? This is not what your vision was, you know? So, and I, you know, it's funny because when I do shoots, I'm getting better at them. I'm a work in progress, everybody is, right? But I'm getting better at them in that, you know, I put props out and the models pick them up. Like, I don't say, you're gonna wear this, I want you to do this. Of course, in my head, I send them a PDF and I send inspo pictures or a clip from a movie like Royal Tannenbaum's or some, you know, art, like a painting I love. Like there's a painting, Barclay Hendricks has a painting of a girl blowing a bubble on a couch. And his practice is really similar to what I do. I've read books about what he does. And reading about artists and knowing who the artist is paramount. If you like the work, that's great, but who made it and why did they make it? How did they make it? When did they make it? Why did they make it? Like that's critical. So I have art books up the yin yang. Like art books are my best friends. So, and also meeting the artist, going to an opening, meet them, say hi, like why not? But yeah, so anyway, doing the shoots, like I've made them more spontaneous. So I don't, my expectations are just, you know, it, when there are the models there, that's not a still life, that's an active participant, right? So, and I only paint people who, I usually know them ahead of time or it's a connection through somebody or whatever. And they really need to embody what the vision is for what I want to do. So I have a prompt, I always have a prompt. And I've sub-screened, you know, words on, you know, shirts and things like that. And on sashes, I have this like one of my screens I have. So it's like, it's got a Western Barbie's a theme I'm doing right now. And so this little baby screen, it's my first screen, I keep it, but I'm going to use it again. So I love like combining, like creating my own.
Wanted to get to that. Yes. Yeah. How interesting that is.
And that kind of pivoted like, okay, I'm going to paint somebody and they're going to look real, you know, cause I do take pride in that, but you know, it can also shoot you in the foot, like but make it look real. And then I'm really proud of my awesome portrait. Well, guess what? Like maybe it could say more, right? So do you think about, you know, the power of that portrait? So putting words on shirts really changed the game. And I've always loved fonts a lot. So, and like John Belushi and the college sweatshirt.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Very important thing, right? Very like, boom, mundane, like right in your face. So I like the idea of just that like font, that bubble. It's a Cooper Black, I think. And it's the velvet letters that used to be ironed on at the boardwalk, the beach. It's also Jim Morrison. It's like Curtis Mayfield. It's, you know, different strokes as the, what do you call it? The italic version. It's everywhere. Google it.
It's sometimes. A lot more places than you think. Yeah.
Oh my God. It's all over the doors and pop culture everywhere. So I love that font because it's very, people respond to it in different ways at different ages. Right. And I just like that you can convey a serious or like kind of like a word is just, you hear it differently by the way the font looks.
Yeah. It's also like a borderline font. It could be very, very sophisticated font because it has a little bit of that serif on it. And then it's also soft enough to be a little bit playful too.
Right. And you mix it with like kind of a realistic painting style.
Yeah, you can really say many things with that font.
Totally. And I've kind of stuck with it. I tried to change fonts once or twice and I thought, nope, we're going to stick with this one.
That's so interesting.
And so Cooper Black's been, I don't know how that even happened. I thought it just had like a weird punch to it, you know? And so, yeah. So that really changed the game in terms of like what the painting could be about and how do you mix like in an incongruous way, a lot of props that don't even go with it, right? Like I actually have props with me. Like I have little, like there's spike bracelets, you know, these, and I have like this little disco ball earring from a party store on 14th Street. And I collect, you want to see a weird one? This came in today. Like I have like this Jaws bathing suit. It's weird, right? So I don't know if
that's I'll ever awesome.
Paint, right? That they, it was made overseas because I guess you can't make it in the US because of the copyright issues. I don't, came in this weird DHL package. So I constantly collect props and then I print on things I get too. V-neck t-shirts. My next shoot I'm doing, I'm gonna have the model cut it in DIY the shirt, you know, so make it a crop top. Because what younger or like youthful models do is they bring that aesthetic they have to it. If I start saying, okay, this is the shirt, wear it like this and pose, you know, if I say I'm gonna do your hair now, I don't do anything because you know, you want to look.
You don't want it to look staged. You want it to be
right. You want that authenticity.
Yeah, right. And for the model, you're not going to feel comfortable at all in the portrait if I'm telling you how to look. That's like, there's a picture of me in the second grade. I went through a very bad phase in elementary school, and I have chapped lips, and I look like really badass with a rugby shirt on. And I remember they combed my hair with those black unbreakable combs. You know, and they combed my hair and put like the cloudy blue sky behind me and they combed it down. I was really mad because I liked my hair like behind my ears and my face shows like how I'm like, no. So that actually, that photograph has taught me a lot about like being in the position of being photographed because I was really upset.
It actually like brings out the most of the model. Like if you give them that freedom, you know, if they're comfortable in that setting and you know, you're probably going to get the best performance out of them.
And sometimes they pick up like all the things out And then they'll see a garment rack or like a thing on the wall. They'll say, oh, I want that one. And I'll be like, go ahead, didn't plan on that. I have little earrings hung up on the wall. Like I put a lot of stuff up and think, what are they gonna do? So it's super fun. And the painting behind me, which isn't done yet, but it's got candy cigarettes and the hair, she did these three little, you know, she likes The Simpsons and like all the little characters on The Simpsons. And she's actually a fashion designer in New York and who I know from years back. So she brought all this great styling to it. So I feel like you have to let your model bring themselves to it. And that's going to tell a better story. And so it's really a collaboration. Collaborating is really important. Dealing with people, if you want to be an artist, is huge. Do not be alone in a room.
Yeah.
That would be very strange. I think it's really important to get out there.
It's interesting, Tara, the way you describe your work and the subject matter, it really comes down, MK reminds me very much of Ange Bell's comfort food type of artwork. Like everything that you make is recognizable, it's identifiable, it brings you back immediately to, like, I'm just picking up this vibe from you that it brings you right back to a time and a place that makes you feel good.
True. That's very true. There's like an autobiography.
What is that time and place for you that do you think? Like what time, like
this? Yeah, where is it? Back? Where is it? Where is
me,
it?
I feel like I have a connection to, you know, but I would love to hear yours.
Like connection to like the, say it again.
Like where does the, like what time period do your paintings take you back to?
Oh God, like, late 70s, early 80s. So like 80s, I saw, like, do you know the movie Xanadu?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. In the theater, that was me. In my elementary school yearbook, fifth grade career choice, I'd like roller skating queen. I wrote that. So like I had these like big dreams as I was influenced by that. Yeah. I think, and then early 80s, like I remember, this is such a weird thing, being from a small town in New Hampshire. We had Studio 54 underwear. I don't know where they came from. Like, and I wish to God, and I was so little, like I was so little. We had a store, like kind of like a, you know, department stores in small towns, you know, you think it's like the Walmart of a town, but it's not, you know, it's like it sells everything. Right. And they had the days of the week underwear and like, you know, I don't know. I feel like I asked my sister recently and she was older and I think I must've been like 10, right? And my memory is really good. And she was like, oh yeah, they came from that weird little store, but we had them and at 54 on your butt. You know, I thought that was the coolest thing, honestly.
Did you have an idea of what Studio 54 was?
Well, you know what? People Magazine, I did. I knew it was a discotheque, and I knew that people were very like, whoo, you know, flashy.
Well, it was a different, it was like a Bacchanal in there. It wasn't just a discotheque. It was like Sodom and Gomorrah in there.
Oh, it was. And so as a kid, through my lens of age 10 or whatever, my sister had like record albums, like, and I would look at the covers and I think, you know, I grasped the visual aesthetic of it, right? Mm. And I didn't know what the moon and the spoon meant. I mean, I thought it was like the cow jumps over the moon, like the little book you read. I didn't. So, right. But I think it was the fashion, that's the vibe. And I love the 5 and the 4, the font, very cool. Mm, so yeah. I would say that era going early into the 80s and then having MTV pop in. And then, you know, high school became high school, but which was fine. I was really kind of dorky and into my academics, but
it's interesting.
Go ahead, Mike.
It's like the imagery, like there's definitely like a sense of nostalgia. You could feel the 80s, you could feel the 70s, but the girl I feel is the contemporary part. Like that, you know what I mean? Like they bring it to today. Like it does, the girl itself.
Yeah.
It's almost like they're playing dress up with the stuff from the past, but you know that the girl is from today.
That's exactly it. Cause I'm trying to find models that are like reflecting contemporary, you know, youth today, right?
Yeah,
definitely. I can't imagine like what these kids are going through compared to my high school experience. I mean, a lot of heavier things are going on. And you know, I like to bring that to it as well.
In terms of the clothes and the props, where did that idea come from? Like I love the idea of putting them in clothes that you have created or recreated.
Yeah.
Where did that idea come from? Was it that you were looking for certain things that you couldn't find were trying to be resourceful?
The first t-shirt painting I made, if you go way down, like it's called High School. I had a model, and this is so funny. So last minute Lucy here, I made a screen super fast. And then I screened, while the model was there, screen printed, blew it dry with a blow dryer. And this is how fast I did this thing. And then I actually had the film ready to shoot. You know how to make silk screens, you need to make the film positive and whatever. And I made the screen instantly because I make screens. I have a little setup in my studio. And and then made the I wrote high school on the t-shirt really fast and thought just like be a, like this generic, like kind of like college John Belushi, like be like a generic, like and blow a bubble. And I said, make two ponytails. She made two, they're like that. You know, they're not even like great. And it honestly was like a half an hour thing. And I thought, okay, maybe I'll do a sketch. And I ended up doing a painting. I made it's like maybe 60 by 48. And I sent work to a gallery that had a call for entries in Tribeca online. And I was like, oh, I'll send some work in. And I had that on my website, but I sent her in this other stuff. She was like, whoa, 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 I like that high school one. I thought, oh, wow, really? You know, because I didn't have any feedback on it. Feedback's critical. I wish I had asked people what they thought of it. She said, I would like that one in the show. I thought, oh my God, cool. So I put it in the show and I think it sold within like the first 15 minutes of the show. A guy came in and said, I want to buy it. And I thought, you do? And I was like, ooh. And so then he said, he was like a financer. He wasn't the last person. I guess he'd never been in the gallery either. It was a random, this is like lightning striking. This is not common. And he said to me, tell me about the painting because I'm going to buy it, but I want to know more about it. And I thought, oh. And I really thought, okay, I might have to bullshit for a minute. But I didn't have a good answer. And so I thought, why did I make it, right? So that made me think, okay, when I make paintings, people are like, why are you making them? So that was a good, like, you know, feet to the fire, like figure it out, girl, if you're gonna be like putting your work, because I didn't expect like this interaction like that. So
that's why you said have those like three sentences about the work.
Yeah. Four is too many. As you know, kids today are like, I can't watch more than like a 20-second video.
Oh, trust
me. So, I mean, I figure like I better have a soundbite that's ready to roll.
But I wanted to ask you, Tara, what actually was more of a statement was that what I love about that whole series with you using the text and the font and it looking so simplistic and straightforward, you're really making it a power statement too.
Oh good.
I mean, is that part of the process of that subject matter? Like when I look at, like I look at one of your paintings and the word says everything.
Right. I'm leaning to that for the show in LA a lot more too. Yeah.
It really does. It brings me back to your whole idea of things being narrative, where you're simplifying that narrative into one or two words on a t-shirt.
Really very few words. And you know, it's funny because one or two words is better. Because it's more direct, right? And
also,
like, they're too small to paint when you're too many. Like, no, really, you want the viewer to walk by and go bang, you know, and like, and painting like sashes. I'm doing a sash painting. And it says piece of work because the girl's like, she's a piece of work. And also, the artwork's a piece of work. So it's like double.
Right.
So there, but there are other, you can really say a lot of things, you know, with
those. Yeah. And I think the less. Yeah. There is the more power you give to that image.
Well, this is really good input. I'm excited.
Well, that's why we're teachers. It's true. Like MK and I have seen your work in person.
Oh, you have.
Yes, we've been taking our students for the past 10 years or so. We take them into the Chelsea Gallery District in the city every year, once a year, and we do bring them around the gallery district. And the last time we were in, MK and I saw a group show at the now defunct Lions Weir Gallery, and you had work up at Lions Weir, and I remember walking in, and it immediately jumps out at you because of. Number one, the composition. I love the nondescript backgrounds. Is that also on purpose?
That's just because I want the focus to be on the model and I haven't overthought it. It's just something I'm like, okay, I want to focus on this. And I mean, usually I shoot them with a backdrop. So I feel like in the future it could change a little, but I kind of like it plain.
It does. And what I love about them too is that they have this cross-reference to traditional Renaissance portraiture.
Thank you so
like,
much.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
You can, you, is that part of the process for you?
You know, it's funny. I've been leaning to like Van Dyke brown and like the darker colors because the bottle glows more, right? And I like the mix of like this super, like behind me, that's like craziness back there. But like it's not super crazy, but the background is like a darker, it's a gray, but it's not super like deep, deep, deep dark gray. But I, I really like Van Dyke brown. I like those rich, rich colors for sure.
Yeah. And it's
in that. Oh, sorry.
No, it's, I was going to say, it's almost a, like I, in my own personal work, I love to contemporize something traditional, which is why I do a lot of tattoo models, pinups, things like that. And I try and do them in a more traditional format because I want to contemporize that look. What I see in, what I see in your work is a almost like a contemporizing of a chiaroscuro type of approach where they're emerging from that background.
Yeah, right, exactly. That's what I was hoping. Wow, I'm so excited. I feel so cool right now.
Would you would you attest to that being in your consciousness when you're painting? That that's what you're going for?
It's very planned. Yeah. I mean that's there was a painting in that show that you saw of it's called Lone Ranger. And the model is where that was a great shoot. I've used that model many times, and she's from a family that they she's grown up with art around her. So she knows what artists do and why. So we've got this amazing model muse who gets it. So she, I had the Lone Ranger hat. She put on the cheerleading skirt, you know, then she's covering up like, you know, cause she's not wearing anything. And it's kind of a nice kind of twist on the Lone Ranger. I love the fact it was like a female Lone Ranger. And there are so many layers to her personality and what that painting's about. So, but that was one of the first times I tried that dark background color to see what, to really mix that classical kind of feel with this contemporary, you know,
that pop culture type of thing. Like, yes.
These things that you never see mixed together. And it somehow still reads as elegant. I love that. And I think that
that's timeless too. Yeah.
Right. And the t-shirts, I really put a bang in there, right? Like, I mean, that's even better in the classical looking portrait. You have this t-shirt. So I'm really, I like that. That's actually what I'm doing now is a lot dark backgrounds because they, it kind of pushes it to the place I want it to be more. So I'm glad you brought that up. Actually.
It does. And it also, it reminds me of another contemporary painter that I have to be I happen to be a huge fan of, who's friends with Dave Leffner, and that's Kelly Reamson. Do you know Kelly
Reamson's work? I know her work. I've never met her, but I know her work. Yeah.
I mean, she has these amazing, powerful female figures. And she, or with an axe or a hammer. It's very similar in this empowerment type of portraiture.
Yep. I love her work.
What can you bring us to in terms of, is there a specific influential artist or art movement that has affected your choice of subject matter?
Well, I'm a super, super duper pop art fan. I mean, a lot of people are, right? But I really love reading the history of pop art. Like there's a Dwayne Hansen cheerleader, by the way, that's like a, you know, sculpture. Just because I paint doesn't mean a sculpture can't be one of my top 10 favorite works of art. Yeah, I like pop. I mean, I like James Rosenquist a lot. Even though my work doesn't really look like that, I like the subject matter being so bold, like lipsticks that are coming at you, like rockets or whatever. Roy Lichtenstein, there's text, there's people, right?
Yeah.
That whole just making thing, pop culture, right? That's pop art. So that I think is the one I gravitate to the most. Of course, Warhol did Polaroids and portraits, but his work doesn't influence me technically, but I think just conceptually having models and are they made iconic or are they already iconic? Like I love that conversation, like what happened there? So I think he's super important, obviously. Let's see, who else? There are lots of contemporary painters I love. You know, I'm constantly watching that. You know, Chloe Wise, I don't know if you know her work. I like her work a lot. And Jenna Gribben. I read ArtNet News every morning, you know, like I'm on it. And I go to gallery shows constantly and I see who's showing there and da-da-da-da. I like those movements. I like... like Barclay Hendrix is like my hero of the moment, actually. And I bought a book called Birth of the Cool. You got to see this book. If you know a lot about his work, it's neat.
No.
Gosh. Okay. Like he really painted like 70s disco Harlem kind of thing. But he was a teacher. I think he was a professor. I don't know where. I don't want to say the wrong thing. But I need to read the book again, I guess. I can't remember. I know his process was he brought models in and they would have like a Superman t-shirt on, or they'd have like, you know, he did a self-portrait actually wearing that. So he was into like adorning people with these wearables that he felt connected to, and then the models felt connected to, and then had solid backgrounds. I saw his work after making my work. It wasn't like I was like, oh my gosh, why didn't I catch on to this?
Tara, I can see the connection so much to your growing up too, though. You're
yeah,
just devouring pop culture as a kid.
Yeah,
totally. And how it's always been there mm-hmm. in your evolution as an artist, right in the forefront.
Right.
Which, I mean, you're unabashedly unapologetic about it.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Like it's funny. I wish if I had grown up in New York City, I wonder if I would have been so, you know,
hungry for it.
Yeah. And aware. And it's such like, whoa, look at that unique thing right there. And so I feel very fortunate, you know, for that.
Yeah. I agree with that. I feel like, and it we see it a lot with our own kids too. The more they're saturated,
yeah,
the more they become stunted and kind of just numbed by it.
Absolutely. Yeah. You can't get out of your own way. Like there's too much.
Yeah. It's almost like overload. There's nothing there that sparks their interest anymore because it's kind of like a seen it, done it, been
right.
there.
You know, it's attainable. It's like, right. You know, it's part of their everyday life, you know?
It's immediate. Right. And yeah, no kidding. And things take hard work, right? I mean, I used to go to the library and go to the card catalog and find a book. I mean, you know, those days of like, you had to look up a phone number. God, imagine that.
Or Tower Records and trying to dig through and find a CD.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I know. Right. Right. So
now everything is right there at your fingertips.
Exactly. It makes me so nervous. And I think, am I sounding like my grandparents right now?
We all are.
You know what though? At the risk of sounding dated though, Tara, I think that for generations that had to go through that, there is a greater appreciation for finding those things.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think that you end up cherishing those types of things. Like we look at your paintings and you have this affinity for the simple bubble font.
Yeah.
At that time, you know, you would go to a thrift store. If you found a shirt that had that bubble font, you'd be like, oh, I have to get this shirt. I can't find this anywhere else.
Exactly, exactly. Oh, that's so interesting.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I was going to say, I keep the t-shirts. Like they're stored in these like, you know, airtight containers. Because I feel like
because
they're very precious.
Yes. And it really is. It's a testament to your appreciation for nostalgia too.
Yeah.
And I still think, I'm sticking with going back to that comfort food mentality about what makes you feel good about yourself and seeing things and bringing you, especially with the year that we've all had, we've been clamoring for normalcy.
Oh yeah.
And something that brings us back to a time where we didn't have to worry about what the hell was going on.
Yep. Yep.
And things were simpler.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. That whole 2020 year was interesting with art in general.
Well, now let me ask you that. I'll segue. How did that affect your working method, your process, your mindset? Did it paralyze you at all this past year, or did it like kind of inspire you?
This is going to sound so bad, but I was so excited because I could I could not be pandemic. Like, trust me, I'm not saying that, but because there, I felt like I could just be inside and get a lot done and I wasn't distracted to go out and about, you know? Mm. So it was this kind of lockdown of like, ooh, it's like almost like a residency in your own studio.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah.
And I thought, oh, wow. And I was behind on a project. I was like, so we can't do that show right now. So
you're like the students that we have sometimes with the due dates. Yeah. Snow day.
No, project is due. I am that person. So, but I did, you know, I managed to do a shoot at the beginning. Actually, the Lion's Rear show that you saw, I was lucky. That was right. That came down. And then 2 weeks later, everything got locked down.
Right.
So I'm glad I had that experience. And then everything was like, you know, so I had that show and that was exciting. And then I was like, okay, now on to the next thing. I bought like 7 or 8 canvases. And my husband's like, what? Why are we going to Brooklyn with this big, RAV4 shoving canvases in? And I said, because what if they close down? I can't get canvases, right? So like I stocked up like a squirrel with the nuts. And I went up north. My family's up north and we have a place. So I was getting work done, you know, there. So that was good. And you know, honestly, I thought, oh, I could do a shoot on Zoom and now people are trying these new things. And I thought, no, I'm going to, you know, so I had enough material to sift through from the past and kind of, you know, it made me think I had the time to stop and look at the series of portraits I had done, which I was rapid fire doing shoots, doing portrait, doing shoots. And I didn't stop to like actually marinate in like the images I didn't choose. And also think, wait a minute, that could have been better with this, or, oh, wait, I want to do this. So, and then I had time to kind of stop and think more about concepts, which was good, and still painted a lot. But I found like I got commissions from people during the pandemic. So I commissioned.
Really?
Great, because that makes it easier to rent a studio, you know. So that's good. And
do you do a lot of commission work?
You know, I did, and I thought, oh cool, another commission. Oh great, another commission. And then they ended up taking up time that I could have made. Granted, my commissions are like, you know, think of a t-shirt word, you know, that kind of like it has to be in the embody what I do, obviously. I just meet somebody's kid with like a little floral dress on. It's fine if you, I'm not the person. So people who knew my work, because maybe they saw somebody with that piece in their house and then they want one of their daughter too, or, you know, a collaboration. So I did, you know, and I participated in some auctions, you know, benefit auctions. And I auctioned off a commission in Aspen to the Aspen Art Museum. And that was, I ended up finishing that painting. So, but once the commissions were done, I thought, oh good, now I can just dive into making work that I feel confident will be in a gallery and sell. You need to sell paintings. Like the fewer paintings in your studio, the better, honestly. If you have a big stack of them in trying to be an artist full time, like you want to make
a red flag
going out the door. I mean, I was so attached in the past, and now I'm like, just get them, go.
Yeah. We know that you have taught in the past and that you do still teach.
Yeah.
How have you found this whole quote unquote new normal, the online teaching?
Yeah.
Because for us, for MK and I, we are tactile teachers.
Me too. Yeah.
We need those students in front of us. We need their hands in it. We need to see what they're doing.
Yeah.
Where do you see the future of art education going? Are we in trouble? Do you hope that this doesn't stay the same? Do you want to include some more of it? Where do you stand on all of that?
That is so interesting, because it was like sort of like dropped in my lap. I thought, oh, wow. Zoom. Thank God I used it, because it makes this thing easier right now. Because I had like Zoom phobia, like, oh my gosh, like that's what I look like right now. You know, you feel like what? And kids are so fluent with like selfies and everything. So I think, you know, I've taught at a school where the kids are, it's at Phillips Exeter Academy. It's the prep school. The kids are really motivated. They choose the class, right? So I've had this experience where the kids are, and I knew some of them from in-person experiences, which helps. But honestly, it's the first term, it stunk. It was terrible. Yeah. I mean, it was really awful. I had a hard time getting used to it. The kids didn't have materials.
Yes.
Because they were international. They were like all over the world. Then you had time zones. We had students in China, students in London, everywhere. So I was
like, I find that we lost keeping them engaged through the environment too. Like we work very hard at creating a physical space that is inviting, that is inspiring, that, you know, like that just forces you to be creative, and it's a safe space as well. Like we always want the art room to be a place of safety and acceptance, and you can come whenever you want. And the fact that we weren't able, at least in the very beginning, we weren't able to let the kids who were off periods come on in and stay there.
Exactly.
Because of spacing issues.
That they affects need that. The work too, because like in a normal year, we have work, like the walls are covered, you know, by this That's point true. In the year, and other kids.
And stuff is on, and stuff is on easels and
off of it. And now it's like they're making everything in a vacuum. You know, yes, they have social media, like their social media, and we have our class Instagrams and we post the work, but they're not seeing as much of the work from their peers as they would on a normal basis. And I think that's hurting the work.
It is. It's also in some ways it's hurting the recruitment.
Yeah.
Also, because you have those you have those lower level kids who come in and say, oh my goodness, who did that? And say, oh, that's the senior portfolio class. And they're I'm going to take that when I'm a senior. Yeah. Like we don't have those moments now.
There's a hiccup where, that's happening.
Right. Where there's a ninth or a 10th grader who sees a senior and then can think back to that during their senior year, say, Mr. Center, remember so-and-so's work when I came in and saw that? Right. Like those are the things that build upon their whole experience. And we've lost that.
And sometimes they don't want to ask the teacher, how did you do that? And they ask each other. And that's the good. Maybe they make a friend. Imagine that, right?
Yeah.
I mean, kids aren't, so that camaraderie or the quirky day you have, and the kids talk about music or whatever, or, well, I don't know what they're talking about, but there's that free flow conversation that they're not going to do it on a screen.
Yeah.
So it's sad. I thought the whole thing was very weird and sad and not good at all.
It's hard to know your students and for them to get to know you as a teacher and as a person too.
Oh, like quirky sense of humor. And it's funny because I don't know how tall people are. Like, I don't know, like all you see, right? There's no manner. And that's tough too, because body language is a huge thing. And 100%. But like you said, seeing the actual painting and that program you create, it's a program, you know? And you want there to be that energy and that spirit.
Absolutely. It's really a lifestyle during that school day. Like, there are kids that come in and all they know all day is how they feel when they're in that room.
Yes,
it's a very much a happy zone, and it brings them a lot of feelings of, you know, safety and love, and, you know, an environment that accepts them. And, you know, those are the things I think that we're going to be dealing with if and when we finally get back to a normal type of environment. I think those are the pieces we're still going to be picking up.
Oh, I do too.
For a while. I really do.
It's going to have an effect for sure. It's going to
be absolutely.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I mean, I think in the future for us, it's going to weigh a lot on us to be responsible for bringing that back.
True.
And working doubly hard to make sure that, like, we are very lucky in our district that we are scheduled to move into a whole new wing next year just for the art and music. So for us to, we have to bring that environment back to a brand new space.
Yeah.
Like, it's like throwing out a worn but comfortable old coat.
No, you're right.
And then putting on like a stiff, starchy jacket and trying to break that in. So now we have that environment plus all the other negative stuff to build on top of that and try and build that back up. It's going to be a challenge for sure. So MK, we are over an hour as always.
Oh no.
It's just, there are so many things about you personally, Tara, that are just so fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
Your work is phenomenal. We just love seeing your evolution.
Oh, thank you.
It has been an absolute pleasure to have you on. I want to thank you so much for joining us.
No, it was super fun.
Everybody who's going to be watching this, get on that and follow Tara Lewis. Her work is phenomenal. We want to thank everybody who's going to be tuning in. And like you say, every episode, keep looking out for one another. Keep loving one another. Keep taking care of one another. Summer is coming, MK. We're going to get there, buddy.
Thank God.
Almost there. Yep, almost there.
We're going to get there. All right. Good night, everybody. Thanks for tuning in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's a wrap.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you, Tara. Bye-bye.